God the Father in heaven, have mercy on us. God the Son, Redeemer of the world, have mercy on us. God the Holy Spirit, have mercy on us. Holy Trinity, in one God, have mercy on us. May we understand your holy will. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we realize our true relationship with you in this life and the life to come. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we continue to work with you in building your kingdom on earth. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we unite ourselves with you in the sacred mystery of the altar. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we recognize the greatness of this most holy sacrifice through which we worship you. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we feed on the bread of life, no more to hunger. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we have a share in the offering of Jesus on the cross. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we fill our lives with your ideals, be joined with you in the supper of the Lord. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we receive always and everywhere your all-pervading presence. Grant our prayer, Lord. May we end our days with your holy name in our hearts and on our lips. Grant our prayer, Lord. Forgive our sins, O God. Grant our prayer, Lord. Cleanse and renew our hearts. Grant our prayer, Lord. Lord, bless us with the wisdom to praise you in spirit and in truth, that by following your holy will, we may gain eternal salvation. Amen. Well, good morning. And last night I heard sleet, and I heard there may be a possibility of snow coming. So that's kind of appropriate, because next Sunday is Advent, and we begin our journey to Christmas. But today is the end of the liturgical year. And so this is probably our last chance to be together, unless you come and join me on Thanksgiving Eve. We'll have Mass again at 6 p.m. that night. But this is our last chance to come together for this liturgical year. And so with that being our theme at the end of the year, the readings also kind of focus on the end of time and the judgment and all of that. And so that's kind of a dreary subject and kind of our dreary day, so it all fits in together very nicely. I do want to mention that I went to a clergy retreat this past week at the Mercy Center down in Madison, Connecticut. Beautiful site, very nice time. And then on my way back, since I was coming from Connecticut and our girls' volleyball team was playing at Holyoke Community College, I stopped in there for their game this past Wednesday, which they did win. They lost yesterday, but they should be very proud of themselves, because I guess there were no seniors on the team. They lost that entire first starting rotation, and they did very well. And so they won Western Mass, and they went all the way to the States and got beat yesterday. They should be very, very proud of themselves. And I got to tell you, I was terrified, though, because that was my first and only volleyball game I had ever been to. And this team, as you know, their record, I don't know, what is it, like 6 straight state championships, 12 Western Mass championships. I go to my very first one. They lost the first set. I said, oh, no. They lost the second set. The third set is the clincher. It's 3-0. It's all done. They're down 4-0. I'm saying, I showed for the first one. I'm going to be the GOAT. They're going to blame on me for showing up. But somehow, after losing 2 straight sets, they turned around and won the next 3. And so I give those girls a lot of credit. And I wish them well next year as well. But as we do gather today, as I said, for the last Sunday of our liturgical year, I ask you to please make a private examination of your conscience. And then we now recite the Confiteor together. I confess to Almighty God, one in the Holy Trinity, who knows the innermost secrets of my heart, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my own great fault. In your presence, God, I publicly express sorrow for the many sins by which I have offended you. I resolve to amend my life, to improve and sanctify it, endeavoring henceforth to serve you faithfully all the days of my life. I ask all of those who dwell within the Church of Christ, the Blessed Mother Mary, the Holy Apostles, the Martyrs, and Saints, who have lived and suffered and died for the gospel of Jesus Christ, as well as you, my brothers and sisters, who witness my confession to our Lord God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May the Almighty and merciful Lord grant us pardon, absolution, and the remission of our sins. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Show us your mercy, Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, most gracious Father, may with purity of heart, we may worthily fulfill this holy action, established in remembrance of the Last Supper and the death of Jesus Christ, and for our sanctification and salvation. Be present among us, Jesus, our most perfect Master, because you said there were two or three are gathered together in my name, you are among them. We also ask, Lord, that through this holy liturgy, we may experience a spiritual revival and a better understanding of your holy will, bringing us together in one great family, guided by your commandments and by love, truth, and justice. And may we say together, let us praise the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, indivisible, revealed in triune power, for all time, now, and forever. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Have no love for the world, nor the things that the world affords. If anyone loves the world, the Father's love has no place in him. For nothing that the world affords comes from the Father. Carnal allurements, enticements for the eye, the life of empty show, all these are from the world. And the world with its seductions is passing away. But the man who does God's will endures forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. In God we have boasted continually. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah,
you have saved us from our foes and have put to confusion those who hate us.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Cleanse my heart and my lips, O my God, you cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. In your mercy, cleanse me so I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Jesus said, when you see the desolating sacrilege spoken of through the prophet Daniel, the prophet standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. And then those in Judea must flee to the mountains. A person on the housetop must not go down to get things out of his house. A person in the field must not return to get his cloak. Woe to the pregnant women and nursing mothers in those days. Pray that your flight may not be in winter or on the Sabbath, for at that time there will be great tribulation, such as has not been seen since the beginning of the world until now, nor ever will be. And if those days had not been shortened, no one would be saved. But but for the sake of the elect, they will be shortened. If anyone says to you then, look, here is the Messiah, or there he is, do not believe it. False messiahs and false prophets will arise, and they will perform signs and wonders so great as to deceive, if it were possible, even the elect. Behold, I have told it to you beforehand. So if they say to you, he is in the desert, do not go out there. If they say he is in their room, do not believe it. For just as lightning comes from the east and is seen as far as the west, so will the coming of the Son of Man be. Wherever the corpse is, there the vultures gather. Immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of heavens will be shaken. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming upon the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send out his angels with a trumpet blast. They will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. Learn a lesson from the fig tree. When its branch becomes tender and sprouts leaves, you know that summer is near. In the same way, when you see all of these things, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all of these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. This is the gospel of the Lord. They weren't only from professional religious thinkers. People in the religion field can become too narrowly focused, I think. I don't think we look out beyond what we're supposed to read in seminary, and that kind of narrows our focus of who God is and what he can do. Specialization is absolutely everywhere, you know that. Just think of all the different doctors that are out there that we all have to go see. If you got something here or there or whatever, there's all these different doctors out there. But what are the specializations? What are the confines of religion? Isn't our God the creator of everything? Doesn't he say something in everything that he has created? Don't we teach that God is everywhere? And not only within a certain number of books, within a certain number of people, but isn't God everywhere? And at the Last Supper, Jesus promises to share his Holy Spirit with us because he says, I have more to tell you, but you're not ready yet. So doesn't that mean that God is still speaking, that God is always speaking in all kinds of ways, through all kinds of situations, in all kinds of places? I don't want religion to be too narrow to miss all of that vastness that is our God. 1,000 years before Jesus, the psalmist wrote these words to be sung in the Jerusalem temple as they were worshiping their God, our God.
The heavens are telling the glory of God, he said. There is no speech. There are no words. Yet their voice goes through all the earth, and this would have been sung in praise of God in that Jerusalem temple. The heavens are telling the glory of God. Now Galileo, he was brave enough to dare to say the exact same thing, that God reveals himself through our study and our wonderment at creation, but his words were banned, and he was threatened by the church, and religion grew smaller. Galileo said, "I do not feel obliged to believe that the same God who has endowed us with sense, reason, and intellect has intended us to forego their use." He challenged the teaching that the earth and we humans were at the unmoving center of creation, that everything danced around us, you know, for all of our glory and enjoyment. But God's revelation reveals a more humble teaching, but also a more inspiring one. We ourselves are part of the grandness of creation. We don't stand separated from creation. We are a part of this wonderful, amazing creation. The stuff we are made of is not simply the dirt from Eden. We are literally made from stardust. When stars are in the process of dying, they build heavier and heavier elements. And then when those stars finally do die, they explode, and those elements go out as seeds throughout all of the universe. And some of those seeds, from blowing up stars billions of years away, billions of years ago, they are inside of us. It's the only way that we are here, because some star somewhere blew up, and we are stardust. This fact alone should fill us with awe at the wisdom and the power of our God. But what's even more amazing is that somehow all of this debris from this billions years long process has endowed us with minds that are able to now look at the stuff of creation and understand and be awed. And I don't know if that is present anywhere else in the universe outside of our God. Think about how vast the universe is, and I really wonder if there's anything else out there that is aware of creation like we are. We may have become, we may be the only thing in the vastness of creation that is conscious of creation. Consciousness. That's that let the reader understand. God has given this amazing tool. We need to use it to understand him. God has granted us the privilege of minds and of choice, and we can send machines that, you know, go through millions of miles, and they go, you know, for years, and they'll hit a moving comet somehow through all the math, because the variables are so small they can actually hit a little asteroid or a little comet. But, you know, as soon as you have the privilege of choice and prediction, the prediction becomes almost impossible as soon as you add that invariable of choice. And we are filled with choices every day. Oscar Wilde, another writer not really loved by religion, once made the same comparison and much more poetically concluded, "Who can calculate the orbit of our soul?" You know, we can hit that comet with a spaceship, but we can't really figure out even who we are or what we're supposed to be, because we are even bigger. There are religious poets who look at us and look at creation, and they wonder if God, the God of creation, has produced surprises that even he himself cannot foresee. They ask us to look out, and then they ask us to look inward and wonder if we are not creative beings ourselves, which is to say that we are unpredictable and full of surprises. And they see this as the effects of being made in the image and likeness of God. And if prediction is impossible, not because God is not smart enough or powerful enough to prove that this could be if he wanted to, but because God is creative enough to let our story unfold, then that means that the end time has not yet been written. Take today's gospel, for example. Matthew's community is one centered in Jerusalem, and one which still counted the temple and its worship as part of their faith practice as early Christians. Only about 150 years earlier, that temple had been profaned by the Greeks, and that's what Matthew was talking about with that desolating sacrilege. Now the Romans have done the exact same thing, but they did it a little bit more efficiently, and they completely destroyed the temple in 70 AD, and it hasn't been rebuilt since. To the Jews, and to the Jewish Christians in Matthew's community, this was interpreted as the beginning of the end time. How could God let these pagans, these ones who are worshiping all this host of gods up on Mount Olympus, how could that God allow his house to not be to be treated like this and then not react? How could he allow this to happen to his people? Because of what happened to the temple, Well, they figured all of creation would have to collapse. And Matthew's prophecy uses the word immediately. The sun will die, the stars will fall, the heavens will be shaken, and Jesus will come back. Well, that was 70 AD. He got it wrong, and it's in the Bible. None of this happened. He says to us today, this generation, that generation of Matthew's readers from the back of the year 70 AD, this generation will not pass away until all of these things have come to pass. Well, they did pass away, and these things did not happen. What this tells me is that there's revelation behind the revelation. It tells me that prediction does not work. Don't waste your money going to all those palm readers and that, whatever that astrology in the paper. Prediction does not work. And it doesn't work because God has given birth to a creative universe, and we're the most creative thing of it at all. The future is not determined. The future depends on what we decide to do now, because that's the way God has made us. And this is a gospel message fully worthy of the final Sunday of the church year as we consider the end time. The end time does not belong to future generations. It belongs to us and every generation, because each generation is building tomorrow's world. What we do today will change tomorrow. Wrong predictions, like we're the unmoving center of creation, or that desolating sacrilege standing in the holy place means the absolute end of time, have proven wrong, and that is not how God works. They are no match for let the reader understand. God has made us like him, says Genesis, in his image and likeness. We have intelligence, so let's not be afraid to use it and then tie that in with religion. And he has given us the privilege of free will. Let's use it responsibly, and that's why we come to church, to learn how to use free will responsibly. Let's not focus on the future as inevitable destruction because of our failures. Let's look to the future as the opportunity for our God-given creativity to make a difference for the better. As people of faith, let us trust that God has given us the gifts necessary, hopefully, not to destroy ourselves, but instead to care for those in need, to care for our creation, and to together build a better world for everyone. May this be our final sermon prayer on our final Sunday of another liturgical year, that next week turns into a brand new liturgical year, and the cycle continues forward, not to end, but to creativity. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. May the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Almighty Lord, this is the week of Thanksgiving. An awful lot of people will be traveling, and we pray for safe journeys for all of them. We also pray at this time for Daniela Asher, recently diagnosed with a brain illness, praying for a successful outcome and treatment as offered by her uncle, Bill Girardi. We also continue to offer our prayers for those battling cancer. Meg Connors is offered by Ellen and Don Strosky, Randy Clements by her grandmother, Dottie Baronas. Fathers Ray Drada and Maurice Lazelle is offered by myself. Richard Poe is offered by the Poe and Foster families. Two-year-old Jack Sela is offered by Mariana Foster. Frank Strosky is offered by the Strosky, Gates, and Kirkendall families. We also offer our prayers for Alex, who is 16 years old, battling lymphoma, Hodgkin's disease, and Alicia, a young mother of three with stage 4 breast cancer, and Liz Richmond, recently diagnosed with cancer, raising 3 young girls on her own, is offered by Cindy Benjamin. We also offer our prayers to the souls of Carl Dickinson Jr., who lost his battle with cancer, is offered by Joe and Peg Buster. Are there any prayers that you would like to offer from the congregation? Yes, ma'am. For Scott Hurley, okay. Anything else? All set. For all of these prayers, Lord, plus the private ones that we keep in our own thoughts, we ask you all, Lord, to bless each and every one of us here gathered, to be with those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. May he rest in peace. May the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, but one being of the Father. Through him all things made, for us and our salvation. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary, and he became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, and fulfilled the scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and the kingdom will not end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord. Father and his Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. For the Son of Man is coming at an hour no one expects. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Bestow upon us your grace, O Lord, so that through these sacraments we may now receive, our souls may be sanctified, and may be worthy of seeing you in all of eternity. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. He freed us from sin and death, and called us to the glory that has made us a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people set apart. Everywhere we proclaim your mighty words, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. Therefore the angels and archangels, with all the saints in the entire church, we lift our hymn of praise to your glory, repeating unceasingly. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We therefore, most merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, the Son of our Lord, we beseech you to accept and to bless these gifts, these presents, these holy, unspotted sacrifices, which your holy church receives from you, imploring you to defend and guide her throughout the world, together with her priests and all true believers of the holy faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. And of all present in this congregation, imbued with faith in your holy care, your rule and fatherly love, wholeheartedly this day, united in spirit with all of those, beginning with the most blessed Mother Mary, Mother of Jesus Christ, likewise as apostles with all the countless hosts of martyrs and confessors who lived, labored, and suffered for the same holy cause which Jesus Christ sacrificed his life in his most precious blood, just as they believed, professed, were united with you through prayer and this immaculate oblation, which you have instituted from the beginning of the world and in time and fulfilled through Jesus Christ, and gave it to humanity as a pledge of eternal salvation. So we too this day profess and unite ourselves with you, most gracious Father, in humbleness of spirit, and accept from your hands this holy bread and this precious chalice as a longed-for gift bestowed on us by the Savior of the world as spiritual food and drink. He promised us this food and drink in that moment when he revealed his divine power by the multiplication of bread and feeding with a hungry multitude of people. Afterward, he foretold the giving of that food and drink to his disciples and friends as a more excellent nourishment when he said, "It is by providence that gives you the real heavenly bread. I myself am the living bread come down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he shall live forever. The bread I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." And afterwards, when the temporal and messianic life of the divine teacher and giver of the covenant was drawing to a close, he gathered into the upper room all those we had loved in a singular way and had chosen to continue his work of salvation. He spoke to them words of deep love, longing, and resolve. "I will not leave you orphaned. I will come back to you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Do not be distressed or fearful. You will suffer the world, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If you live in me, and my words stay a part of you, you may ask what you will, and it will be done for you. Anyone who loves me will be true to my word, and my Father will love him, we will come to him, and make our dwelling place with him. I consecrate myself for their sakes now, that they may be consecrated in truth, that all may be one as you, Father, are in me, and I in you,
I pray that they may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. I give them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I living in them, you living in me, that their unity may be made complete. Father, all those you gave me, I would have in my company, for I am to see the glory of mine, which is your gift to me, because of the love you bore me before the world began. I myself am the bread of life. No one who comes to me shall ever be hungry. No one who believes in me shall ever thirst. After these and other words of the archpriest in prayer, and with holy fervor, our Savior took bread into his holy and venerable hands, and having lifted his eyes to heaven, to you, his almighty Father, giving thanks to you, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body, which is given for you. In like manner after supper, taking this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again he gave thanks to you, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant, which shall be shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants and your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as well as his blessed passion, resurrection, and glorious ascension, receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith, they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly ask, O mighty God, command that our offering be brought by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, into the presence of your divine majesty. That we who receive the most sacred body and blood of your Son from this altar may be filled with every blessing and grace, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. To these souls, Lord, and to all who rest in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who during life strayed from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully shorten their suffering. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part of fellowship with your holy apostles, martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name. Their hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and with lives patterned after their divine master, merited eternal joy. Number us in their company, Lord, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By whom you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and freely give us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray, instructed by our Savior's teaching and following divine example, we say with confidence,
Thank you.
deliver us, Lord, from all evils, past, present, and future. And by the intercession of the blessed and glorious Mother of God, Mary, together your blessed apostles, Peter and Paul, as also Andrew and all the saints, grant us peace in our day, supported by the help of your mercy, that we always be free from sin and secure from all disturbance. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always. May the union of divinity and humanity in Jesus Christ bring us sanctification and eternal life. Amen. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, my peace I give you. Now look at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and grant us the peace and unity of your kingdom. You live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, by the will of the Father and the work of the Holy Spirit, your death brought life to the world. By your holy body and blood, free me from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me faithful to your teaching, and never let me be parted from you, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness may become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. In this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last unite me to you with you, my Lord and my God. Grant this who lives and reigns with God the Father, in unity with the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to everlasting life. Amen. What shall I return to the Lord for all the graces that he has given me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. High praise will I call upon the Lord, that you be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy to speak, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Thank you. God's presence, and the Word was God. He was present to God in the beginning. Through him all things came to be, and apart from him nothing came to be. Whatever came to be in him found life, life for the light of men. The light shines on in darkness, a darkness that did not overcome it. There was a man named John sent by God, who came as a witness to testify to the light, so that through him all might believe. But only to testify to the light, for he himself was not the light. The real light which gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and through him the world was made, yet the world did not know who he was. To his own he came, his own did not accept him. And he who did accept him, he empowered to become children of God. These are they who believed in his name, were begotten not by blood, nor by carnal desire, nor by man's holiness, but by God. And the Word became flesh, and made his dwelling among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of an only Son, coming from the Father, filled with enduring love.